Hey now, Rodney R. Dixon here, and today I'm going to be showing you how to completely format a hard drive. That is to say, erase everything on the hard drive to be used with a Microsoft Windows operating system. Now, it's important to note when I say Microsoft Windows operating system, I'm referring to a Microsoft Windows in which you own the install disk to install your Microsoft Windows operating system. That is to say, not a Microsoft Windows that is supplied with a name brand computer, such as HP, Dell, Compaq, Gateway, eMachines, what have you, Acer. What I'm saying is for those who own a legit copy, a store-bought copy of the Microsoft Windows operating system, that is to say Windows XP and above, this method will ensure that your format is complete, is fresh, and will not cause any issues from previous formatting. In order to do so, what we're going to be doing is we're going to be deleting the master boot record of the hard drive. Now, the master boot record is a small section of the hard drive which stores the formatting information of the hard drive, how the hard drive was formatted, what partitions the format entails, what's the type of structure of the partitions, and what have you. By performing a format on a hard drive that does not delete the master boot record, what you're doing is you're creating new partitions. You're perhaps deleting old partitions and creating new partitions. However, you're maintaining this old master boot record. Now, this can cause many issues when formatting a hard drive, especially if your hard drive had, for example, recovery partitions or support information or things of this nature that is often hidden in hidden partitions from big name manufacturers like, once again, HP, Dell, Compaq, Acer, eMachines, all of these. So, what this will be doing, once again, is completely erasing everything on the hard drive by destroying the master boot record on the hard drive so that a new one can be created with the fresh format, which we'll be doing in Microsoft Windows. So, in order to do so, we're going to be requiring Hyren's boot CD, as Microsoft Windows cannot delete a master boot record on its own. So, if you do not have a copy of Hyren's boot CD, it can be obtained on the following website. Now, important to note, what I'm going to be showing you requires the following. Let's say, for example, the computer you are wishing to format you cannot access it. What you'll be requiring, if not accessible on your current computer, is another computer with the following: high-speed internet access, at least a CD burner, it can be a DVD burner, what have you, and an empty CD to write Hyren's boot CD to. That being said, on the computer that has access to high-speed internet and a CD burner, what you're going to do is you're going to visit www.hyrensbootcd.org. The page should appear as so. Important to note, you're going to see a lot of advertisement banners with large download buttons. Do not click them. They're ads that lead to different softwares, not the software you want. What you're going to do is instead you are going to click on the download tab available right here. Once you click on the download tab, once again, beware of these banners that try to trick you. These are not Hyren's boot CD. Instead, what you're going to do is you're going to scroll down. And towards the bottom of the page, you should see this icon with file name Hyren's boot CD blah 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 dot zip. As of this date of recording, the latest Hyren's boot CD was version 15.2. Since this date, Hyren's boot CD might have been updated, so your version may differ than mine. Nonetheless, you're going to click on file name Hyren's boot CD 15.2, and of course you should elect to save the file. You're going to wait till the file downloads. Once it completely downloads, important to note, as you can see, Hyren's boot CD 15.2 is a zip archive, so you'll need the ability to uncompress zip archives. So the way you test this is once you download the file completely, you right-click on it and you look for the options to extract, to uncompress, to unzip, something of this nature. If you have software to do such a thing, then great, you could use that software to uncompress the zip archive to a folder of your choice. If you don't, I recommend you obtain 7-zip, available at 7-zip.org. This is open source freeware software, which, because of the source code being readily available to the community, shouldn't have anything nefarious such as spyware, adware, malware, trojans, viruses, anything of that nature. On that subject, I'll also mention that as of Hiren's boot CD 15.2, I performed an AVG virus scan on it, and it reported no such problems. Once again, no viruses, adware, spyware, any malware, anything of that nature. Once again, I could only vouch for 15.2. I don't know if later versions may have something. Okay, so if you require 7-zip, available at 7-zip.org, essentially you're going to click on the link that corresponds to your operating system. If you run a 32-bit Windows on the computer you're going to burn Iron's boot CD on, you get the 32-bit version by clicking this download link. If you run a 64-bit version of Windows, you're going to click on the 64-bit version by clicking on this download link. Once you download the software, you are going to right-click on the software. If you downloaded the 32-bit version, you're going to select either Open if you're on, or Run if you're on Windows XP. If you're on anything later, Windows Vista and up, you're going to select Run as Administrator. And if you downloaded the 64-bit version, you're going to right-click on the file once it's downloaded and select either Apply or Install. It's one of those two. You're going to go through the method of installing. Once the software is installed, what you're going to do is, with the zip archive. Now, this is the method to do so in 7-zip. If you have a different uncompressing software, you'll hopefully know how to run yours. You right-click on the zip archive, Hiren's boot CD, that you downloaded. You mouse over 7-zip, which opens up the submenu, and you select Extract Files. With Extract Files, it'll ask you where you want to extract. I decided to browse. I decided I was going to extract it to this hard drive. You could extract it wherever you want. And I selected Make New Folder, and I created a new folder, gave it a name, and selected OK to extract the archives. Once the archives are extracted, they'll appear as so. As you can see, Hiren's boot CD is an ISO image, a disk image. If you have software that you're familiar with burning ISO images using, you can feel free to use that. However, if you're not familiar with burning an ISO image, or you're not entirely sure, luckily, Hiren's boot CD comes with a burning utility, which is great. All you have to do is run this burn-to-cd.cmd. If that doesn't work for you for some reason, you can run burn-cdcc. Once that's done, you ensure that Hiren's boot CD is indicated here. If it's not, you click on Browse and you navigate to your Hiren's boot CD ISO file. You could leave all these options checked: read, verify, finalize, auto eject. These are all fine. You'll want to put the empty CD to CDR, or if you have to use a DVD, DVDR, in your writable drive. I recommend speeds of no greater than 16x for a CD and no greater than 4x for a DVD. This ensures that the burn is sure-footed, is a proper burn where everything will read more or less perfectly. From there, you click Start. It is possible that burn CDCC may nag you to insert a blank disk, even though you already did. If you did, you could try clicking OK. If that doesn't work, try ejecting the disk and reinserting the disk, so opening and closing your tray, and trying again. I had to try a few times before it would actually properly read the disk and start to burn on it. When it begins to burn, as you can see, writing image to disk, You simply wait for it to complete. I highly recommend that during this burn process, you do not use your computer for anything. No web browsing, no chatting, no Facebook, no email, no whatever people, no games. Do not do anything with your computer. Just leave it burn. Because if you cause something to slow down or otherwise crash either your computer or this program, you'll end up with a disk that's worthless. You'll scrap a disk. So I highly recommend you just leave everything as is, unless your computer has a power scheme whereby it goes to sleep after a certain amount of minutes. Let's say, for sake of argument, this shouldn't take longer on a modern burner. It shouldn't take longer than maximum 40 minutes. If you have a computer that goes to sleep before 40 minutes of inactivity, what you'll have to do is you'll either have to turn off that power saving scheme if you know how. If you don't know how, you'll have to painstakingly sit in front of your computer and move the mouse every once in a while, ensuring your computer doesn't go to sleep. Once the burn's completed, of course, you can eject the disk and go over to your destination computer where you wish to format the hard drive. What you're going to do is you're going to insert, you're going to power up your computer, you're going to insert the Hiren's boot CD into drive, close the drive, and then restart your computer, whether it be with a reset button or powering it down and powering it up. The goal is to see this screen. However, if you do not see the screen and instead your computer ends up booting up what was previously on the computer, such as your operating system, what you're going to have to do is you're going to have to go into the BIOS settings in order to set the boot device priority. Now, this can differ, or this will differ, from computer to computer. What I'm going to show is how to perform such on an award modular BIOS. It is most likely that yours will differ, however, the process should be similar in all cases. Essentially, what you're going to do is, as you're booting up your computer, you'll see a screen such as this. It's possible that you don't see a screen such as this, and instead you just see a logo of the manufacturer. If you do, essentially, what you can do is you can alternatively and repeatedly press F1, Delete, and Tab. Over and over and over. Hopefully that'll get you into your BIOS. If you do see a screen like this that indicates what button to press to enter setup, press that button. If after this you're still having trouble getting into your BIOS, you'll have to Google the model of your computer plus the word maybe get BIOS or get into BIOS, and you might have find better results online. Okay, so a BIOS resembles this, more or less. Now, what a BIOS is, this is what's known as the built-in operating system. It essentially governs and helps save all the settings that govern what components are installed into the computer and how they interoperate between each other. So, it's important to note that, for the most part, BIOSes are not navigatable by mice, or a mouse, I should say. You have to use the keyboard and arrow keys. What I recommend you do is, in this case, if your BIOS resembles this, essentially what you're going to do is you're going to navigate to the portion where you set up the boot device priority. If yours resembles mine, your BIOS, you can press the right arrow until boot is highlighted and then press enter. This will lead you into the boot order. And what you're supposed to do is you're supposed to ensure that whatever your CD-ROM drive is, that it appears before your hard drive, whatever your hard drive is. Your device names will most likely be different. So let's say, for example, in this case, Hitachi DVD-ROM was appearing below WDC. It was appearing where this is appearing, INT18. What I'd have to do is I'd have to move it so that as it appears here, Hitachi falls ahead of WDC, ahead of my hard drive. And this can be done on an award modular BIOS, at least, by highlighting the item you want to move and pressing the plus and minus keys to move it up and down. Once your boot device priority has your CD-ROM or DVD-ROM or what have you, your optical drive ahead of your hard drive, you are going to highlight the exit tab, and you are going to elect to exit and save changes. Once that's done, your computer should automatically reboot, and hopefully Hiren's boot CD boots up, such as so. Once it boots up, what you're going to do is you're going to, once again, using your keyboard, you're going to go down to highlight DOS programs. Once that is highlighted, you're going to press enter. From here, instead of highlighting and accepting testing tools, you're going to highlight and accept partition tools. In partition tools, what you're going to do is you're going to highlight and press enter on Ranish Partition Manager. You're going to run that. This is Ranish Partition Manager, and as you can see, here I have many, many, many partitions on my hard drive. What I'm going to do is I'm going to leave the highlight on Master Boot Record, and if you press F1, you could see what the various commands are. In my case, Erase Partition is E, which is perfect. I'm going to press E with the Master Boot Record highlighted. And it reads, are you sure you want to erase everything on this partition? Your options are no, cancel, or yes, fill it with zeros. You highlight yes, fill it with zeros, and press enter. Now it's important to note, when the master boot record is destroyed, all partitions are no longer active, they're no longer available. But what just happened? We elected to, yes, delete the master boot record. Why are we still seeing all this? It's because the software doesn't auto-update itself. So what I recommend you do is once you do that, you exit. You quit the software using escape. It'll bring you back to this screen, which is kind of a quasi-DOS environment. Here you could press the letter M, like memory, and you're going to press enter. From here, once again, you're going to highlight partition tools and press enter. This interface is different, but you're going to highlight partition tools and press enter. You're going to highlight Ranish Part Manager and press enter on it, and this restarts Ranish Partition Manager. However, this time it reread the situation, and as you could see, everything's gone. All the partitions are gone because we deleted the master boot record. There's only a primary partition which is indicated as unused. If you wish to know if your hard drive has any bad sectors, you can move the cursor down to highlight the unused partition, the ones with all the numbers and figures on it. And once again, looking in the help file, we see that V is verify partition surface. So you could escape on the screen and press V to verify the partition's surface. And that's how that works. Unfortunately, like I said, I don't know how the software works to take note of which parts of the hard drive are in fact faulty. So this is only a for your information process if using Ranish Partition Manager, and it will let you know if your hard drive has bad sectors, and if your, you know, generally bad sectors are indication that sooner or later your hard drive will fail. So if you do have bad sectors and you want to continue using your hard drive, I recommend you, I recommend that you keep that in mind, that your hard drive will soon fail. So do your backups frequently, and don't take backups for granted. Moving on, once this is done, what we're going to do is we are going to boot up our Windows setup disk. So we're going to eject the Hiren's boot CD, we're done with it. We're going to insert our Windows install disk in the optical drive of our computer. Going to close the optical drive and reset the computer, or power off and power back on, and the Windows setup should begin, as shown here. Important to note, if we had no bad sectors in the bad sector check, and we're only installing one version of Windows, we're only installing the Windows you're installing right now, you could feel free to just press enter on this, format the partition using NTFS. You could even select NTFS quick, since the bad sector check was performed previously with the other software. And there you go. Your hard drive has a new format, a new partition, a new install of Windows, and you should have optimal performance and capability of your Windows environment. However, if sector check, or you wish to install multiple versions of Windows, so multiple boot environments, that is to say, for example, maybe you want to install Windows XP and Windows 7, both on the same hard drive, what you're going to do is you're going to have to create partitions. So instead of just pressing enter on this item, what you're going to do is you are going to create a partition in the unpartitioned space, which here is indicated by pressing C. In my bad sector's at 3100, I'm going to make my first partition 3000 megs. Boom, I'm going to press enter on that. Now you can see my first partition is around 3000 megs, and then I have unpartitioned space. I'm going to highlight this unpartitioned space and once again create a new partition. Now, very important, if you are installing multiple versions of operating systems, dual boot, if you're installing Windows XP and then Windows 7, for example, this next step, this unpartitioned space, you're going to do this when you boot Windows 7. Don't do it in Windows XP. For example, what you have right now, if your goal wasn't to avoid bad sectors, it was just to create multiple partitions for different operating systems, then leave it as is at this point. Press enter on the partition you created, whatever the divide is that you decide, and you install Windows XP on that partition. Once Windows XP is installed, you recommence the installation procedure with your Windows 7 disk, and what you're going to do is you're then going to create the partition on the unpartitioned space for Windows 7. Important to note, when you're making dual boot environments, you always have to begin with the oldest operating system and move up to the newest. You can't, for example, install Windows 7 and then decide, oh, you know what, I'll put Windows XP on the other partition. You can't go backwards. You can only go forward in chronology. Okay, that being said,